Hello and good afternoon. Welcome to community members wherever you are in the globe, especially LGBT community members living along the equator and in the global south. Welcome to our Spanish-speaking Caribbean presentation as part of the English and Spanish-speaking Caribbean. We would like to invite you to share about our event with those who you know who may be interested. So let us begin. So we'd like to welcome you. I apologize for that long period of silence because I'm trying to do everything here by myself. So we'd like to welcome you to this afternoon's LGBT people of color representations in Latin culture. We'll be featuring this afternoon Professor Arnaldo M. Cruz Malave, who interviews Professor Lawrence Fountain Stokes on trans locus and LGBTQ plus people of color in Puerto Rico. As part of our program, we will have a moment of silence where we honor and remember community members who we've lost to suicide, homicide, and COVID virus and HIV. We will talk about what the Global South Summit is. We will acknowledge our partnering organizations and participating organizations. And then we will introduce Richard Morales from the LGBT Center, who is going to then introduce Professor Arnaldo Cruz Malave, who will then introduce and speak with Lawrence LaFontaine Stokes. And then we will wrap up this afternoon's program with a look at our upcoming events and look forward to next time. So, we'd like to ask you to take a moment in silence as we remember and honor and invite into this afternoon's discussion those of in our communities, especially living along the equator and in the global south, who we've lost to homicide, suicide, HIV, AIDS, and COVID-19, the pandemic that we're still living in. We'll ask that you bring into this space, into this meeting, into this forum, our community members who are still struggling with the long-lasting effects of this COVID virus. We ask that you bring into this space community members who are still living and struggling with HIV. And we ask that you bring into this space community members who are struggling and living in conditions or situations where it's unsafe, where they are subject to domestic or intimate partner violence, and where they suffer from family, community, including from their own LGBT plus Q communities, oppression, and from their respective states and countries. So let's take a moment in silence and bring these community members to mind. Thank you. This LGBT People of Color Global South Summit, when we consider that Black and people of color living along the equator and in the Global South are the largest population on Earth, and since LGBTQR plus people of color are present in all communities, we affirm that our communities constitute the largest sub-demographic in the world. We are aware that when international media often report on or about LGBTQ people of color in the Global South, these often follow a tragic event. Our community's pain is often pathologized and exploited. Rarely, if ever, do we hear, see, experience our community members' richness, beauty, vibrancy, and resilience. We hope to change that image. We want LGBT people of color who live along the equator and in the Global South to be seen and heard. We want to highlight and celebrate LGBT people of color lives. And even though representatives in the diaspora created a framework for this summit, representatives who live in the Global North, it was imperative that community members reclaim their voice and provide the programming from their respective locales. They tell us, they show us who they are, how they live, how they celebrate, and how they mourn. We'd like now to acknowledge and thank our planning team members. We have planning team members from across the globe. We have from South Africa and Liberia, from Nigeria, from the Dominican Republic, from Thailand, from Guyana, from the US, from the Philippines, from Zimbabwe, and from India. We acknowledge and we thank our partnering and participating organizations, Black Gay Blog in the UK, The Clemente, In My Mind, DBGM, XAD Productions, the LGBT Center here in New York City, and Claimant Designs. We thank Caribbean Equality Project, and from the US and covers both the US and the Caribbean. We would like to thank ECAID that's based in the English speaking Caribbean. We would like to thank Creme de la Creme House of Fame Foundation and Instab Niger from Nigeria. We would like to thank BN Foundation Transition from South Africa and Zimbabwe Rainbow Community in Zimbabwe. We would like to thank APCOM in Thailand, Baby Babi Lanes in the Philippines, Kias in Indonesia, in Cambodia, Suarta Kita in Indonesia, and Micro Rainbow Foundation in Laos. This afternoon, our moderator will be introducing our two panelists, Richard Morales, who is with the LGBT Center. He's the manager of community partnerships at the LGBT Community Center here in New York City. He was previously manager of public programs at El Museo del Barrio. Originally from Brooklyn and of Puerto Rican descent, Richard attended Oberlin College, where he studied Latin American studies with a concentration on literature and the fine arts. He has independently curated exhibits and events that address inclusion, representation for the Hispanic Federation Fuerza Fest, and for the Leslie Museum of Gay and Lesbian Art. He currently serves on the board of directors for Teatro Circulo, the Clemente Soto Velez Center in New York City, and the podcast Making Gay History. Following Richard, he will be introducing Professor Arnaldo M. Cruz Malave, who will be interviewing Professor Lawrence LaFontaine Stokes. Professor Arnaldo Cruz Malave is a professor of Spanish and Comparative Literature and Associate Director of Fordham's Latin American and Latinx Studies Institute. He is the author of Queer Latino Testimonio, Keith Haring, and Juanito Extravaganza, Hard Tales, published by Palgrave in 2007, a book about the relationship between art and Latinx popular culture in gentrifying New York of the 1980s. El Primitivo Implorante, published by Rodopi in 1994, a study of the intersections of nationalism and queer sexuality in the fiction of Cuban author Jose Lezama Lima, and editor of the anthology of short stories by the Puerto Rican queer diasporic author Manuel Ramos Otero, in Cuentos Casi Completos, published in Havana, Casa de las Americas in 2019. And he co-edited with Martin Manalasansan of Queer Globalization, Citizenship and the Afterlife of Colonialism by New York University in 2002. He has been the recipient of the NEH and the Ford Foundation Fellowships, a visiting professor at Harvard, and a former member of the board of directors of the Center for Lesbian and Gay Studies of CUNY's Graduate Center and Fordham University Press. Professor Lawrence LaFontaine Stokes will be discussing trans locus and LGBTQ in Puerto Rico. Professor Lawrence LaFontaine Stokes is professor of American culture, romance languages and literatures and women's and gender studies at the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, where he directed the Latino Studies program for 6 years. He was born and raised in San Juan, Puerto Rico, and received his AB from Harvard in 1991 and his master's in philosophy and PhD from Columbia in 1999. He is author of Queer Ricans, Cultures and Sexualities in the Diaspora, University of Minnesota Press in 2009, and of Escenas Transcaribeñas, Ensayos sobre Teatro, Performance y Cultura by Isla Negra Editores in 2018. And co-edited with Deborah Vargas and Nancy Raquel Mirabal of Keywords for Latina or Latina Studies by New York University Press in 2017. His recent book, Trans Locas, The Politics of Puerto Rican Drag and Trans Performance, University of Michigan Press in 2021, is part of the Triangulations Lesbian, Gay, Queer Theater Drama Performance Series. He has co-edited queer issues of Centro Journal, Sargasso and Hostos Review, Revista Hostostiana, and has published 2 books of fiction, Uñas Pintadas de Azul, or Blue Fingernails, and Abolición del Pato. Larry performs in drag as Lola von Miramar since 2010, and has appeared in several episodes of the YouTube series, Cooking with Drag Queens. Community members, I'd like us to welcome both Richard Morales and Professor Arnaldo Cruz Malave and Professor Lawrence LaFontaine Stokes.
I want to give a short introduction to our panelists.
And to our panelists today. Our first panelist is Arnaldo Cruz Malave, who is a professor of Spanish and comparative literature and associate director of Fordham's Latin American. Since 2010 and has appeared in several episodes of the YouTube series Cooking with Drag Queens. So
thank you. Thank you, Richard.
Well, thank you, Richard. Thanks the center, especially during this month of gay pride, LGBTQ pride. And it's an incredible pleasure to be here with my very, very good friend, who I've known for many, many years, Larry LaFontaine, to celebrate this incredible book. With a beautiful name and a beautiful cover, Translocas, the politics of Puerto Rican drag and trans performance. So let me start by saying that Translocas is, to my mind, it is the most encyclopedic and extensively archived book on Puerto Rican trans and drag performance. It is also a general theory of the aesthetics of and practices of Puerto Rican drag, but also it contains very minute and It is, as you know, if Carmelita Tropicana were talking about this book, I would, you know, just borrow her words. It is mucho multi, you know, it is it is excessive, like the subject matter. It is multicultural in a good sense of the term. It is multimedia, multi-hemispheric, archipelagic, and some a word that Larry uses throughout the book. It is a sort of rassemblage. It's a Haitian Creole term to talk about the kind of the bringing together of disparate elements, and it is, in a word, it is how he has termed it. It is translocal. Let's start. I'd like to start by asking Larry to define the term translocal for all of us translocas. Why have you, Larry, decided to use, to deploy this term transloca to define Puerto Rican drag and trans performance? What are the diverse meanings of this term? What are the advantages of using it? What kinds of meanings and mappings does it evoke to you? And what is its politics, as the subtitle of the book is, the politics of Puerto Rican drag and trans performance? So, Larry, could you speak about that?
Yeah. Thank you, Arnaldo. Thank you for your kind words about the book. Thank you for seeing it as a rassemblage in and of itself. In other words, as a bringing together, as an encyclopedic project, but that also hopefully goes in depth to explore very specific certain people. The term transloca is an invented word. It was a word that I started using at the beginning of the 2000s. This project took almost 2 decades and had many different versions and iterations, because at first I did not realize it would be a book. At first I thought it was just an article. And loca is a word that circulates extensively among gay Puerto Rican communities and other Spanish-speaking queer communities. It is a playful word. It is an insult. It's a complicated word. It is a word that has in-group meanings, but they can also be offensive. So it is a word that it's like the word queer, which is also a complicated word. Translocality is a critical term that acknowledges movement back and forth, the relationships of people who are living in multiple places or who maintain ties with people in different places. And for me, translocality really embodied the experience of Puerto Ricanness in the 20th and 21st centuries, that of being a diasporic nation, as people such as Jorge Duany have termed it, of moving back and forth, of having family in both locations, of living in both locations, and especially now through the advent of technology, of just having the possibility of being very up to date. What happens in Puerto Rico, what happens in the United States, and then sort of seeing queerness, drag, and trans in that context of movement, translocation, transnationality. So I thought that I had been very clever and original when I first came up with the term transloca, a neologism or a new word. It turns out other people were also using it slightly differently. Leonel Cantu in California had proposed the use of the term transloca to a group of transnational feminists working on Latin America and the issue of translation. So it is not I can't claim exclusive origins for the term, but I thought it was a provocation. The term transloca, it is edgy, it is complicated, it is provocative. Some people are very excited, they find it very productive. Some people have really resisted it as a label. So I used the term to bring together a number of contemporary artists and activists from the 1960s until now. And sometimes when the artists find out that I am using this term to identify them, they don't like it. So I have made the distinction between being a transloca, which is or might not be somebody wants to self-identify with, and talking about transloca performance. So transloca performance acknowledges that the work, the artistry, the films, the performances, the solo theater of some people can be analyzed critically using transloca performance as a lens, which recognizes the specificity of Spanish language. In other words, that it is different to be gay or queer or pato or maricón in Spanish. It's not the same as being gay or queer in English. So that was my interest in using the word loca to mark the specificity of language, how in the case of Puerto Rico, the Spanish language is an important language to understand our queer LGBTQIA experience, and that Puerto Rican drag, Puerto Rican trans performance is different. It happens in English and in Spanish. It happens moving between Latin America, the Caribbean, and the United States. So it ties together many different points in that geographic map, but it also brings together language and cultural experiences in very different ways. So I think that is why I use the word transloca. That is why I made it up. And that's what I'm hoping that people get out of the book, that notion that there is something specific, different, and unique, not only about Puerto Rican, but also about Latin American and Caribbean drag and trans performance, because people in other cultural contexts in Cuba, in Brazil, in República Dominicana, have also seen the word transloca as a useful term for what they do. The analysis of the performers and the artists and the people in different countries in Central, South, Latin America, and in the Caribbean.
Great, great, great. Yes, that's what's so exciting, that is actually that you emphasize the performative, that you emphasize the experience, that you emphasize the locality and localization. You play with the term localization, actually.
And that localization can sometimes be New York. It can sometimes be Chicago. It can sometimes be San Francisco, California. But it can sometimes be San Juan, Puerto Rico. It can sometimes be en las montañas, en Ay Bonito, donde se encuentra ahora mismo Mickey Negrón, for example. So it's a term that moves, that changes, and that people can adopt and transform.
It can be Miramar, where you are right now, right?
That is true. I am from a neighborhood in San Juan called Miramar. That is why my drag name is Lola von Miramar, or Lola from Miramar in German, because when I created a drag character, which occurs kind of in the middle of this experience, I started out writing a book about drag and trans performance because I love drag and trans performance. It was really about writing about other people, about documenting their work, about understanding their work, about analyzing their work. And in the middle of everything, Fausto Fernos, who appears in this image, who's a Puerto Rican drag performer in Chicago, said, "Larry, we need you to get a dress, to get a wig, and to get to Chicago. We want to make a Cooking with Drag Queens video with you." And I thought, this is crazy. I don't see myself as a performer. I had never wanted to be a performer. But the people I am writing about who do drag think it would be hilarious or interesting, or they want to collaborate with me. And that was really interesting in terms of me as a professor, as a scholar, as a writer, actually doing the thing that I am writing about. So my experience was complex. it entailed learning a lot about makeup, about costume, about performance, about wigs, about girdles, muchas cosas que yo no me imaginaba, many things I never imagined that I would learn. I think I'm able to write in more detail, for example, about the performer's makeup, because I have had that experience of having to learn how to do all those things. But the same thing, but the other thing that happens is that when you dress in drag, you're profoundly aware of danger, of risk, of putting yourself, of making yourself vulnerable for being attacked. Well, not simply criticized by people, but literally attacked, because there are many people who have very strong feelings against transgender people, against drag queens. In a culture of sexism, it is very easy to want to beat up a drag queen or a transgender person. So I felt that very profoundly. I felt the joy and the celebration of the audience, because people just get so excited and happy when you are in drag. But at the same time, I felt the profound fear, el miedo, el malestar. So for me, that tension between the happiness and joy of drag and trans performance and the fear and the real threat and the violence against people who are non-gender conforming, I think that is really at the heart of what I call transloca epistemologies.
Yes, and that, you know, comes through in the writing and in the analyses of the performances. And it strikes me that that you begin with a chapter that is precisely about that dichotomy between between joy, the joy that these performances produce to the person who is performing, as well as to a whole community that is established.
Yes.
Through them. But also, you know, the anxiety, discomfort, the kind of profound disturbance that goes beyond just simply being disturbed about the binaries between genders. Goes beyond that. It goes to all other kinds of, as you show, other kinds of social categories. And so I was wondering if you could talk about that first chapter, because it is so discomforting. It is a chapter where you talk about loca epistemologies, how to view the world precisely through that lens as you perform. And so you talk about the performance of Nina Flowers, the successful performance of Nina Flowers, her achievements in RuPaul's Drag Race, and then you link or you juxtapose the experience, the tragic ending of Jorge Stevens Lopez Mercado in Puerto Rico, who was assassinated in Puerto Rico, and Kevin Fred. Could you speak about that and how you constructed that kind of juxtaposition, and what was the intent to place that at the very beginning of what would otherwise be a rather joyous, you know, inventive appreciation of drag performance?
Yes. So I think that is really that. I started the book thinking that it was really more about celebrating, documenting, and acknowledging the extraordinary talent of very specific artists. But at a certain moment, for example, Nina Flowers. So Nina Flowers is a performer, Jorge Flores, who started their career in Puerto Rico in the 1990s. In the 2000s, she moved to the United States. She appeared on season one of RuPaul's Drag Race in 2009. She got on by the votes of her fans. And she transformed the use of the word loca, because she used the word loca on the show. She also recorded several songs. Her first single was called Loca. Her second single was called Locas in the House. In other words, people across the United States, Latin America, and the entire global viewership of RuPaul's Drag Race became familiar with the term loca because of how extraordinary Nina Flowers is. And that is remarkable. And it is complex because, of course, RuPaul's Drag Race is a business. It is a money-making business, which is legitimate. But then at the same time, we have to understand neoliberalism. We have to understand co-optation. We have to understand how the complexity of economics form part so that it is not just happy performance. It is performance that has a certain goal and that can be used by certain people to make money. So that is one side of translocura, of translocas, of Puerto Rican drag performance. But a different side is what happens, for example, when people are the victims of violence. So I highlight the case of Jorge Steven Lopez Mercado, who died at the age of 19. He was murdered in Puerto Rico. This was a murder that received a lot of attention. Thousands of people went to his funeral. It was very violent. It was very traumatic. It was horrible. And some people are still to this day affected by this violence. Jorge Steven performed in drag. He went to drag shows. He had friends who were sex workers. He has been accused, correctly or incorrectly, of having presented in a feminine way or as a woman by his murderer. We do not know if this is accurate, and it should not matter. But what does matter is that he was killed when he was very young for being queer, for being loca, for being effeminate, for performing in drag. And this was more than 10 years ago. And as I was finishing this book, there was yet another murder. In fact, these murders, there is an epidemic of violence against transgender people and against queer people and against women in Puerto Rico. So the murder of Kevin Fred in 2019 was also very disturbing to me. In this case, Kevin Fred was starting to become very famous and very well known as a queer trap singer, el primer trapero abiertamente gay, the first openly gay trap singer. So I was interested in analyzing his videos, Soy Así and Diferente. I was interested in documenting Kevin Fred's life and trying to understand who is he? What is his art about? So I was interested in talking about the controversies related to his murder, but more I was interested in positioning my work and the conversation, acknowledging the horror, the violence, the risks, but also the celebration, the potential, the happiness. So that for me is Puerto Rican queer and trans experience. It is moving between these polar opposites.
Yes, and despite the fact that biography and experience can be disabling and even annihilating, as in these horrible assassinations, the performances that you present also deal with destitution and abjection. And I'm thinking specifically of the, what you call the performance, the drag of poverty.
Yes,
correct. That Erica Lopez and Holly Woodlawn,
yes,
deploy. They're able to create a sort of camp that actually does not trivialize, but what struck me about your reading is that it actually exposes the discourses that make that victimization possible. So could you talk a little bit about this,
this yes.
chapter and...
Yes. So the chapter on welfare queens and the transloca drag of poverty is precisely an acknowledgement that the it's not only violence. Violence is not the other challenge, the only challenge that some translocas experience or that many translocas experience. poverty is another of the challenges that translocas experience. And here, so this was a really interesting moment in the book because Erika Lopez is a cisgender, bisexual Afro-Puerto Rican woman in San Francisco. So in other words, she is not a drag queen. Well, that's an interesting question. Maybe she is a drag queen. She is a drag queen. I don't know if she claims that identity or that label, but her performance is very excessive. And that excessive performance of Erika Lopez in her show, The Welfare Queen, which she did in the early 2000s, was precisely about what happens when you are an artist that does not have an income, that does not have a job, and that goes on welfare and is stigmatized, has to negotiate the stigma that the government, that society puts on poor people who need government assistance. And she, in this performance, she says, welfare queens are the drag queens of the next millennium. And I just found that a very provocative phrase. It is a phrase that is humorous. It is campy. For some people, it might be profoundly offensive, because it is re-signifying or re-elaborating social issue of poverty, of marginalization, and of welfare. And she does it in an empowering way on stage in her one-woman show, using music, breaking down, crying in the middle of the show. So I thought, this is incredible. I'm writing about drag and trans, but you know what? Women, cisgender women, are giving me the tools to talk about Puerto Rican poverty. And as a way, for example, to jump back to 1970, when Holly Woodlawn appeared in Andy Warhol's film Trash, which was precisely about being considered trash, having people see you as trash because you sell trash. Your job is to collect things in the garbage, to try to resell. You're also moving drugs. You're also trying to get on welfare. So it is a very humorous film, which of course, for some people, is really about making fun of Holly Woodlawn. But Holly Woodlawn, being the extraordinary performance she was, she really transforms it. And she transforms it into being an empowering statement, well, a statement that negotiates between that abjection and that celebration and that recognition of, I am a valid human being. I am a Puerto Rican. I am not trash. I am trying to survive. I am a sexual being. I have a handsome boyfriend who unfortunately is addicted to heroin and can't have sexual intercourse. But the film, her humor rescues what could have been a very offensive film. Andy Warhol was not really interested, and Paul Morrissey could not have cared less about Puerto Rican poverty. But Holly Woodlawn uses humor and camp and the transloca drag of poverty to negotiate a very complex situation. And then what I was really interested is in seeing how more recent people like Monica Beverly Hills in 2013 in RuPaul's Drag Race has done something very similar. And also thinking about Silvia Rivera, because Silvia Rivera, so Monica Beverly Hills is the first transgender person on RuPaul's Drag Race to openly state during the filming of the show that she is transgender, but she was stigmatized on the show. They made fun of her for being ghetto. She also grew up in poverty. She negotiates poverty. She never talks about welfare, but she does talk about the challenges of being poor. Silvia Rivera, on the other hand, from the late 1960s, working with Marsha P. Johnson, working with the Gay Liberation Front, working with the Young Lords, was trying to challenge American society in terms of the way it treats poor people, but also challenge the gay and lesbian movement for its racism and for its anti-trans prejudice. So for me, putting Erika Lopez, Monica Beverly Hills, Holly Woodlawn, and Silvia Rivera, four Puerto Rican women, putting them in conversation about the challenge or the problem of poverty and the potential uses of humor seemed very generative.
Yes, I would call that a rassemblage, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I love that. I love that because I only use the word rassemblage in the chapter on Freddy, Freddy Mercado, but I think you are right in seeing the whole book as these crazy juxtapositions. Es una metodología loca. It is using madness or locura to put things together that other people, it wouldn't occur to other people to put them in conversation.
And to have that kind of conversation that did not happen, that kind of conversation that was implicit, it's sort of futuristic in a sense,
So that is true because that is true. Silvia Rivera never spoke with Erica Lopez and with Holly Woodlawn and with Monica Beverly Hills. The four of them were never in the same room. It would have been fascinating.
Would have been, yes. And I think it's really a kind of rassemblage that would resonate with many people, African-Americans, Mexican-Americans, poor people, but it certainly, puts the finger in la llaga in the, of Puerto Ricans, because it really brings us all back to that issue of the culture of poverty that Oscar Lewis presented as we, all of us, really having a culture of poverty, and which in the end is about colonialism. So I think
I agree.
That is a fantastic way
So you have highlighted blackness. So I think the issue of race and its relation to poverty is really very much at the heart of that chapter, and to understand. So Puerto Rican poverty is not exclusively Black Puerto Rican, but blackness does affect the experience of poor Puerto Ricans very much. And colonialism, very clearly, because being colonial subjects, having second class US citizenship, living in a nation with the perception that you are inferior, that your people are second class, that you're not the same, that you're all dependent on welfare, that you are all poor. So those things mark the experience of people like Silvia Rivera, clearly, who was homeless. She lived on the street for most of her life. She organized homeless people. People like Monica Beverly Hills, who ended up as a sex worker when she was a teenager. She ran away from home. Holly Woodlawn ran away from home, lived in Times Square, worked in sex work. Many of these women were incarcerated. Many of them were the victims of sexual violence in prison. So acknowledging that is the reality, not only of Puerto Rican translocas, but of many queer people of color, many poor working class people, white people, Black people, indigenous people. So there are lots of potential solidarities to be made. And I try to integrate that bibliography, for example, by citing Kathy Cohen. Kathy Cohen is a leading Black lesbian political scientist.
Yes, your blog is actually exemplary. When I talk about an archive, really the way that your generosity, let me just say it out loud, your generosity, the way that you integrate so many people. And again, let's return to the term rassemblage, because I'd like you to talk about Freddy Mercado. And you also talk about his ultra baroque performances. And I'd like you to speak about him, because in a sense, he is at the center. He's not only on the cover, he is on the cover, but he is at the center of your methodology, as well as your theory, the general theory of the book. Could you talk a little bit about Freddy Mercado?
Yes.
Controversial.
Yes.
Performance.
Yes. Yes. So Freddy Mercado is on the cover of the book. Freddy Mercado is also in the center of the book, quite literally. The middle chapter is about Freddy Mercado. And Freddy Mercado is really what inspired this project. because my fascination or obsession with the extraordinarily bizarre, creative, unusual, different drag of Freddy Mercado, an artist in Puerto Rico. He's a painter. So not only does he perform, but he also does self-portraits in which he portrays himself. So for example, you can see in this image, he negotiates whiteness and blackness. He creates discomfort because people are always uncomfortable when they don't know if a person is male or female, or when they perceive that a male person is presenting as female. People in Puerto Rico become very uncomfortable when they don't know if you're white or black, if you're in between, but it is not clear. People in Puerto Rico in this image, or in many places, you can see Freddy is embodying an explicit sexuality. So she is revealing her breasts, or these painted breasts. But Freddy has also become an animal or a monster. He is an eagle with toy soldiers as a crown in a country that is colonized. So talking to us about imperialism. So Freddy Mercado really blurs or pushes the boundaries between humans and non-human animals, between blackness and whiteness, between masculinity and femininity. And he is constantly creating. So he creates animal characters. Sometimes he portrays historical figures like Mirta Silva or Doña Fe. So Mirta Silva, one of the most extraordinary Puerto Rican singers from the 1940s, 50s, and 60s. And Freddy Mercado dresses up as her, and people go crazy. So he does archival drag. So he brings forth, he resurrects these people from the past, from our collective queer camp transloca imaginary. So for example, gay Puerto Ricans are obsessed with Mirta Silva, not only because she was lesbian, but also because she was scandalous, obscene, and mean and abject. She was very overweight. She told fortunes on television. She was a gossip queen. People love to hate her. So what happens when Freddy Mercado becomes Mirta Silva? Some days, because other days he's becoming a giraffe or an eagle or a black and white person. And for some people, this is very uncomfortable. So for example, Freddy's negotiation of blackness as a person who sometimes is perceived as being of African descent and sometimes is not. I think that is what rassemblage and what transloca epistemology is about. I think that is the ultra Baroque drag of rassemblage, the Baroqueness, simply because of the excess. It's like never ending. There's so many iterations of these different characters. The costumes are so complex that sometimes it's overwhelming to try to understand what is going on. So I like that confusion. I find that confusion productive and important. I think making people uncomfortable is what art is supposed to be about. It is one of the things that art is about. And Freddy Mercado, who has now become very stigmatized because of his exploration of race, is an artist that I really feel is central to our understanding of Puerto Rican drag and trans performance.
Yes, we could say, you know, that he's kind of triggering, you know.
That is correct. He has always been triggering since 1990, for 30 years, as a poor artist, as a gender nonconforming artist, as a fat artist. He has triggered many people for the last three decades.
Yes, and one of the spaces that he uses to do this triggering, to exhibit himself, is usually at exhibition openings. So there he also blurs the boundary between art object and spectator. And that's very unsettling to people who see themselves as spectators.
Well, I think that is what performance is about. Performance is a very particular, performance art is a very particular kind of art. It is not theater. It is not painting. It is not sculpture. In fact, it is a combination. It envisions a very direct relationship with the audience. The whole purpose is about getting audience members to think differently. And, you know, it's very interesting. I do not use the word trigger in the book. It was not a critical concept that I thought of. But I think that it is useful to understand why people are so uncomfortable with Freddy Mercado, why people are so uncomfortable with translocas, whether it is because they are homeless, because they are feminine, because they are Black, or because they are poor.
How can I put this? Larry, I think I think, you know, for me, your most moving chapter is about Lady Kateria. And I don't know if it is for you. I mean, I see you so much as a spectator. I mean, it is titled Adoring Lady Kateria for some reason. And so I was wondering if you could talk to about these two diasporic Puerto Rican drag performers, Lady Kateria and our good friend and much admired friend, Barbara Herr, and who have very, very different styles, right? And so I was wondering if we could include that, you know, in this conversation, these kinds of different styles that were really produced in a place where I live in Jackson Heights and then moved on to spaces in Manhattan, notably the legendary La Escuelita. Could you talk to us about that? Again, it's a very moving and a very meticulously researched chapter. Where you actually narrate and you see, one feels that one is present in these performances.
Oh, yes. Thank you, Arnaldo. So chapter 7 is the last chapter of the book. It is called Adoring Lady Kateria, Knowing Barbara Herr. And it was precisely about that experience of going to the club, to the nightclub to see the drag, to see a drag show, which is a key part of LGBT, queer, loca, marica experience. Like the club, the bar is where we get to be ourselves. And the drag show is where we get to celebrate a very particular type of artistry that is profoundly different from what other people do. So Lady Kateria was one of my favorite drag or technically trans performers in La Escuelita in the 1990s. And I was just overwhelmed by her. I just thought she was extraordinary. She was a transgender woman. She was just stunningly beautiful. At the same time, she was so engaging. Her outfits were always spectacular. The audiences went wild. She was a master of lip sync, of dancing, and especially of burlesque choreographies. So for me, the 1990s, as a young loquita in New York City, having arrived to go to grad school, going to a Spanish-speaking club near Times Square on 38th Street in a basement that was kind of dingy and grungy, but where they played salsa and merengue and house and disco. And then having this spectacular drag show with somebody like Lady Kateria, as well as others. So I was really interested, number one, because I never heard Lady Kateria speak. She never talked, at least the times that I went to her show at La Escuelita. So I was really interested in what does it mean to be dazzled by a transgender woman performer who has invested in changing her body and in making her body into a work of art, but at the same time, never listening to her talk. So I was really struck by that conundrum. Of course, many people did talk to Lady Kateria, her friends, her family, and many people did get to hear Lady Kateria give speeches because she was a contestant in the Miss Continental pageant. And right now you can actually watch those videos on YouTube and Lady Kateria will talk to you. about her negotiations, how she overcame drug use. So I was just fascinated by the mystery of this person who I've never heard in this space. The space of the nightclub is such a special, la discoteca para nosotros y nosotras es un espacio tan y tan fundamental. And then I thought, oh, what happens when you juxtapose or when you create this crazy rassemblage, when you position Lady Katiria next to her trans daughter, Barbara Herr? Because Barbara Herr is also a pageant winner. She is also a trans performer. She excels at lip sync. She is college educated. She graduated from La Universidad de Puerto Rico, the University of Puerto Rico. But the main difference for me is that as an actor, as a performer, Barbara Herr never shuts up. She is always talking. She is talking on Facebook. She's talking on Instagram. She's talking on stage. She's talking in the space of the bar or the cabaret, but she's also talking in theatrical spaces. For example, in her one woman show, Transmission, from 2017. And for me, that was incredible because for me, adoring Lady Katiria was about the mystery of not really knowing the backstory. And the fascination with Barbara Herr is precisely about knowing so much, because Barbara Herr is so open and so generous. In fact, she wants to educate us. She wants us to know, what is it like to go through a gender correction surgery when you are in your 60s? What does it mean to be older? So not young in your 20s or in your teens or in your 30s. What does it mean to be a transgender Puerto Rican woman in her 60s who is getting a gender correction surgery and who has this life experience, like 40 years of artistic experience? She is like a walking history. She is a legend. Barbara Herr, all of these women are legendary. And I was really interested in like teasing out, understanding, documenting, and sharing how wonderful Lady Katiria was and how wonderful Barbara Herr is.
Yes, there is a quote that you begin with, you begin your book with, is from Paola Arboleda, that reminds me of their performance and the performance style, and especially very vividly of Lady Katiria. And it's a quote that says simply that, but very wisely and very astutely, that what is missing in queer US queer theory, one of the things that is missing besides social context, etc., is just simply love. And if there was anyone who actually personified, spoke of love through her body, was Lady Katiria. It was about the embrace. And this is something you describe, how people can't wait to be close to her, you know, how she creates a community at that legendary place, La Escuelita, through her ability to embrace, to make everyone feel that they're part of her. And so, I agree.
So in that chapter, I talk a lot about the experience of tipping a performer, of going up and giving them $1 or $5 or $20, either putting it in their clothing. Talk about being intimate with a person, like touching them to give them money. And sometimes Lady Katiria would kiss you. Sometimes she would hug you. Sometimes somebody would go and throw money in the air. So there's an element of the political economy. There is an element of not being poor. There is an element of recognizing the circulation of money. But there's also an element of affect, of human emotion, of cariño, of abrazo, of intimacy. And for me, that was just fascinating. There is an element that links drag and trans performance to sex work. There is an element that links this close embrace to community. Like, the nightclub, the drag show is where we go to be one. And with the complexities, it's not all ideal. There is money involved. Money can be dirty, good, and bad. There is touching involved, which can be offensive and violent, but also can be restorative, it can be nurturing, and can be loving. So Paola Arboleda Rios proposes that love is one of the things that queerness is missing in English, in American queer theory. Paola Arboleda Rios looks and theorizes for that love in the work of people like Reinaldo Arenas or Néstor Perlonger, Néstor Perlonger and Pedro Lemebel from Chile. So I borrow her critique of American queer theory in English language. I bilingualize it. Because all of these women are moving between English and Spanish. I give it an injection of love and I try to say, this is what Latinidad, what queerness, what Puerto Ricanness, and what translocura is all about. It is about love. It is about objection. It is about violence. It is about community and celebration. It is about Lady Catiria. And it's also about Erica Lopez and Barbara Herr and Freddy Mercado.
So perhaps we could finish with a few seconds of Lady Catiria's love that we all need to remember and to recognize, especially during these hard times and during this month of pride, global pride. I also want to say a thank you, Larry, for this inspiring conversation. I hope everyone has the thrill of reading your book because they will come back to it many times. Congratulations, Larry. Maybe we can finish.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Arnaldo. Thank you so much, Richard. Thank you so much to everybody who has listened to this conversation, this interview. And let's enjoy Lady Catiria's video. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. That's the way love goes.
That's the way love goes.
That's the way love goes.
That was incredible. Muchas gracias, muchas gracias.
Thank you very much, Richard, and thank you very much to Lawrence LaFontaine Stokes and to Professor Arnaldo Cruz Malave for this wonderful description and presentation on trans locus and what that means. So we are so really grateful to have that that story. So we'd just like to resume now and conclude our presentation with with some of our upcoming events for the continuation of the LGBT People of Color Global South Summit. So coming up, immediately next Wednesday is a presentation, a panel discussion that looks at a return to society in a post-pandemic world. What does, how does the returning to a post-pandemic, how does that impact mental health, LGBT people of color mental health? And I'll be moderating that panel with Kenita Placide from ECAID in St. Lucia, with Bong Zendima, who's just been a first runner-up in Mr. Gay World South Africa, from and the founding president of BN Foundation in South Africa, with Midnight from Thailand, and with Anjali Rimi, who is a member of the Hijira community from India. Who will be talking about what it means, what does it mean for our communities returning to in a post-pandemic world? What does life look like? And then on June 18th, we continue our travel across the world, and we experience programs from West Africa, Nigeria, with presenters representing Creme de la Creme House of Fame Foundation and Insta Niger in Nigeria, and from South Africa. In Nigeria, the host for the Nigerian program is Bolo Okupe, who is the son of a prominent Nigerian politician who now lives in exile. And because of his father's political situation in Nigeria, is living in exile. So Bolo will be moderating, hosting the West Africa, the Nigerian segment. And in South Africa, from representing South Africa, is host Bong Zendima, who will be hosting the program featuring presentations by Transition, which is a transgender organization in South Africa, and Zimbabwe Rainbow Community from Zimbabwe, from Harare in Zimbabwe, on June 18th. On June 23rd, we will have a panel discussion that's presented by Southeast Asia communities, by the organizations in Southeast Asia, and they'll be looking at, are we leaving no one behind, moving toward LGBT economic inclusivity in Cambodia, Laos, Indonesia, and the Philippines. And on June 24th, we'll be looking at life at the intersection of race and gender in the South Asian diaspora, with presentations from Prince Manvendra from India and Lala Patel, also from India, and other presenters representing the Asian continent. And then finally, between June 28th and the 30th, we expect to present the Middle East and North Africa region with presentations on visibility deconstructs myths, lies, and prejudices where we will look at artist visibility and writing for visibility from LGBT communities along the Middle East and North Africa region, including Iraq, Syria, Iran, Lebanon, Palestine, and Egypt, and many of the other North African countries. And we also close our Global South Summit on the 30th. And we ask the question, when and where will our Global Summit be next year? So once again, thank you to our community members and our partners for joining us and sharing in this Global South Summit. Community members, we look forward to seeing you on June 9th and again on June 18th and beyond.